沙特油田遭袭，胡塞武装主动出列，谁是真正凶手？
The Iranians supplied the Houthis with missiles and weapons and advisors. The Iranians sent Hezbollah operatives to Yemen to help the Houthis, and so it was Iran launching the aggression against us.
中东恐怖势力不绝，根本缘由何在？
Intolerance, it's
ideology,
hate.
风云对话专访时任沙特外交大臣阿德尔·朱拜尔。 沙特阿拉伯王国位于沙特阿拉伯半岛上的产油大国，全球23%的石油都来自这里。沙特的 GDP 总量在中东排名第一。自上世纪40年代中期美国与沙特缔结同盟以来，沙特一直是美国在中东地区重要的战略合作伙伴，两国在石油资源和地区局势等方面相互依存。 与此同时，沙特作为“一带一路”沿线的重要国家，近年与中国的关系稳步前进，投资贸易关系密切，高层互访频繁。9月20日，中国国家主席习近平应约同沙特阿拉伯王国国王萨勒曼通电话。此时的应约通话很受外界关注。今年2月，沙特王储穆罕默德·萨勒曼曾率千人代表团访问中国。王储一行人抵达北京的第一项活动就是登高游览巴达岭长城，领略壮阔的北国风光。穆罕默德王储访华期间，共签署了35份总价值超过280亿美元的经济合作协议，涉及石油化工、制造业、新能源、通信等各行业。 他表示希望中国“一带一路”倡议与沙特2030愿景对接，将中沙两国全面战略伙伴关系推向新高度。Now
the Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman attracts a lot of international attention. I mean, as a Chinese, I'm more or less the same age as him. I wonder what his personal character is like and what is his view in regard to China and working with China.
He has farsightedness, he has vision, he's bold, he's courageous, he's determined to improve the lives of Saudi citizens. He has been the visionary behind Vision 2030 that seeks to transform Saudi Arabia, reduce our reliance on oil, open up other areas for investment, empower our youth, empower women, make our government more transparent, more efficient, instill a culture of productivity and innovation and initiative and technology in Saudi Arabia so that we can provide the space for young people in Saudi Arabia to be able to improve their lives, contribute to our development and raise our country to new heights. This will make us more prosperous, it will make us more stable, it will make us more secure.
So with the Saudi Vision 2030 in place, what would change in Saudi and what will remain unchanged?
Everything will change. Accept our faith and our values. But everything will change in terms of how we look at ourselves, how we interact with the world, the type of economy we have, the type of productivity we have. We sit at the crossroads of civilization between three continents, Asia, Europe, and Africa. We want to take advantage of this. We want to be a transportation hub. We want to be a technology hub. We want to be a hub for innovation. We want to be a part of the global economy, and we want to be take advantage of the global economy. We want foreigners to invest in Saudi Arabia and we want to invest in foreign countries.
And how do you find the China's Middle East policy in general?
China has a very wise policy. China's approach is not to interfere in the affairs of other countries. China is a country that respects international law. China is a country that does not lecture. China is a country that wants to resolve conflicts peacefully. China is a country that wants to engage in a positive way. And this is something that we respect and that we welcome.
在9月20日，习近平与萨勒曼的电话中，萨勒曼通报了近日沙特石油设施遭遇袭击的有关情况。习近平强调，中方对沙特石油设施遭遇袭击予以谴责，这一事件给海湾地区局势和国际能源市场带来冲击，希望事件得到全面、客观、公正调查。 2019年9月14日，全球最大石油输出国之一的沙特阿拉伯巨头企业 沙特阿拉伯国家石油公司的两处油田受到无人机袭击，造成油田多处设施受损，并燃起大火。此次事件直接导致沙特石油产量减半，全球各大股指的原油价格上涨接近20%。在袭击发生过后，美国在第一时间将矛头指向伊朗。尽管也门胡塞武装主动站出来宣称对袭击负责，美国依然相信是伊朗所为。实际上，在也门发生的血腥内战，表面上看是政府军与胡塞武装之间的武装较量，但在背后发力的却是沙特和伊朗。
Then how about the situation in Yemen? Can we at least see a ceasefire in the near future?
It's up to the Houthis. People forget how the war in Yemen started. We had a GCC initiative that was led by Saudi Arabia that led to the stepping down of President Saleh and the creating of an interim government headed by President Hadi. We brought the Yemenis together in a national dialogue. Yemenis from all walks of life came and discussed the future of Yemen, and they agreed on what Yemen should look like. Then they were going to draft a constitution, and while this process was going on, the Houthis moved from Sa'da to Umran, took over Sana'a by force, overthrew the legitimate government, and now we have a situation where a radical militia, allied with Iran and Hezbollah, is in possession of ballistic missiles and took over a vitally strategic country in the region. This cannot stand. The legitimate president of Yemen called for support. We responded, along with 10 other countries, in order to extract Yemen from the grip of the Houthis. And we have said from day one, the solution to Yemen is a political solution, but the Houthis have to give back, have to withdraw. They cannot control the country. The Houthis are Yemeni. They have a right to be part of the political process, but they have no right to control the country. They're a very small minority in Yemen, and they want to control the country by force. That's not going to stand. And so, meanwhile, as the fighting is going on, the Houthis are using child soldiers, boys 9, 10, 11 years old. They're laying mines all over the country that have led to the death and destruction and wounding and maiming of innocent people. They have used people and hospitals and schools as human shields. They have launched more than 150 ballistic missiles at cities and towns in Saudi Arabia. They have launched more than 200 ballistic missiles inside Yemen, randomly against civilians. They steal humanitarian assistance and sell it to enrich themselves. And they starve people by laying seeds on towns and villages. Why aren't people being critical of them?
Are you aware of the criticism in the international community of the bombing with no discrimination?
Yeah, but we take issue with it. We deal with it every day. We have more than 40,000 targets on a no-strike list in Yemen. We are very careful about selection of targets and assessing the damage after the target is struck. When we believe a mistake was made, we investigate and we make amends. But what I'm saying is nobody seems to be holding the Houthis to task for the crimes that they are committing. The Iranians supplied the Houthis with missiles and weapons and advisors. The Iranians sent Hezbollah operatives to Yemen to help the Houthis. And so it was Iran launching the aggression against us.
中东恐怖势力不绝，根本缘由何在？
Intolerance. It's
ideology.
Hate.
风云对话专访时任沙特外交大臣阿德尔·朱拜尔。自2015年也门前总统哈迪从胡塞武装的软禁中逃离以来，在沙特为首的联军打击下，也门的医院、学校和工厂以及大部分基础设施在战争中被夷为平地。根据联合国的报告，在沙特的封锁下，也门爆发饥荒，目前有1700万人的食品安全状况没有保障。由于医疗设施被毁，也门目前正在遭遇全世界范围内最严重的霍乱疫情。 联合国教科文组织的报道指出，在海湾国家联军的轰炸当中，大量也门历史建筑被毁。同时有媒体指出，在伊朗的支持下，胡塞武装势力范围得到稳固。与此同时，也出现占领区胡塞民兵对历史遗迹进行挖掘和破坏，出售出土文物以充军饷的行为。有媒体指出，也门政府与胡塞武装之间的战争，实际上是沙特和伊朗之间的一场代理人战争，双方冲突的局势不断恶化，此时的也门正在水深火热当中。
So according to the international community, the war in Yemen is a proxy war. So by nature, it's a war between Iran and Saudi. Do you acknowledge this?
We did not start this war. We did not want this war. And I explained to you how we got into this war. The Iranians supplied the Houthis with missiles and weapons and advisors. The Iranians sent Hezbollah operatives to Yemen to help the Houthis. And so it was Iran launching the aggression against us, not the other way around.
How big a threat do you see Iran?
Do we see who?
Do you see Iran as? How Iran, big a threat is Iran?
Iran is the biggest threat to security in the world. Iran is responsible for sectarianism. Iran is responsible for exporting terrorism. Iran is responsible for interfering in the affairs of other countries. Iran has caused problems in Lebanon, in Syria, in Iraq, in Bahrain, in Yemen. They believe that every Shia belongs to them. Their constitution says that Iran has to export its revolution. Before 1979, you had no sectarianism in the Middle East. There was no Sunni or Shia. Nobody knew the difference. After the Khomeini revolution, sectarian fires were stoked, and all of the problems in the Middle East were magnified because of Iran.
So, I mean, in your eyes, what could be the solution to restore the peace in the Middle East?
Iran needs to change its behavior. Iran needs to respect international law. Iran needs to respect the principle of good neighborliness and non-interference in the affairs of others. Iran needs to stop supporting terrorism.
So Iran back down?
No, Iran behave. Iran act like a normal country. Iran stop assassinating diplomats, stop blowing up embassies. Act in accordance with international norms and international law, and the world will accept you as a good neighbor.
朱拜尔，沙特原外交大臣，2018年底在扑朔迷离的原因猜疑当中，朱拜尔由外交大臣转任外交国务大臣。朱拜尔曾是沙特王室有史以来第二位没有王室血统而身居外交大臣一级的重要官员。他有着丰富的求学经历、多种语言技能，以及被外界公认的超级大脑。
You have been ambassador to America between 2007 and 2015, 8 years, with a minister rank. So you see, we know America is always keen on getting fellow countries on board with the Western democracy. It seems like this kind of intent or attempt never goes to Saudi Arabia. How do you understand this?
We will not allow anyone to dictate to us what we should or shouldn't do. We will develop at our own.
You think America was dictating some other countries?
And I mean, the U.S. has its own policies. They have certain preferences of what they would like to see, what they would not like to see.
In general, how do you find America's the Middle East policies in the last 2 to 3 decades?
America is an ally of Saudi Arabia's and has been since the mid-40s. America is a large investor in Saudi Arabia. We are big investors in America. America is a strategic partner of Saudi Arabia's. We have many common interests with the United States. We have solved many common problems with the United States, and we work very closely with the U.S. in almost all areas. But that doesn't mean that we allow people to lecture us about what we should or should not do. One of the things we have in common with China is we believe in the sovereignty of nations. We believe in the principle of non-interference. We believe in the principle of abiding by international law. We believe in the principle of letting countries develop at their own pace in the manner that is best, most appropriate for those countries and those societies. We don't lecture other countries about what they should or shouldn't do, and we don't accept lectures by other countries about what they should or shouldn't do. And I think this is where Saudi Arabia and China have philosophically a lot in common that then acts as a basis for having a very solid relationship across the board.
沙特油田遭袭，胡塞武装主动出列，谁是真正凶手？
The Iranians supplied the Houthis with missiles and weapons and advisors. The Iranians sent Hezbollah operatives to Yemen to help the Houthis. And so it was Iran launching the aggression against us.
中东恐怖势力不绝，根本缘由何在？
Intolerance. It's
ideology.
Hate.
风云对话专访时任沙特外交大臣阿德尔·朱拜尔。沙特作为地区大国，有着相当大的影响力和号召力。例如，在2017年6月5日，在沙特的领导下，海湾地区四个国家共同决定与卡塔尔断交，并对其实施制裁，理由是卡塔尔支持恐怖主义和破坏地区安全。同年7月18日，海湾四国提出了6条原则，以解决断交危机。面对苛刻的条件，卡塔尔拒绝妥协，形势陷入僵局，一直到今年5月才出现了缓和迹象。然而，离危机的彻底化解似乎还有很长一段距离。
So how's the situation with Qatar? What would be the conditions for you to agree to even go back to the negotiation table with your Qatari counterpart?
Well, the problem with Qatar is a very simple one.We have zero tolerance for extremism. We have zero tolerance for terrorism. We will not tolerate people who finance terrorists. We will not tolerate people who interfere in our domestic affairs. We believe that harboring known and wanted terror financiers is wrong. We believe that allowing your most senior religious figures to go on television and justify suicide bombings is wrong.We believe that paying ransom to terrorist organizations like Hezbollah in Iraq and like the Quds forces in Iran and like Al-Qaeda is wrong. We believe that interfering in the affairs of other countries is wrong. These are all the things that Qatar is doing. And what we have said is we said enough is enough. We talked to them over the past 20 years. It didn't work. In 2012, we withdrew our ambassadors. They agreed to stop this.And here we are 5 years later, they haven't done anything to stop it. This is where we said, we're not going to deal with you. We cut off ties with Qatar, and we said to our Qatari neighbors and brothers, if you want us to deal with you, you have to stop doing these things. When you allow your religious scholars to go on television and say it's okay to have suicide bombings, this is negative for the whole world. When you allow wanted terror financiers,to operate freely in your country, raise money, and send it to Daesh and Al-Qaeda, this is wrong. And is it wrong of us to ask them to abide by international norms and to stop promoting violence and extremism and terrorism? Of course not.
According to many, including the former American State Secretary, that all the points laid out for Qatar to comply are really difficult for them. And according to them, they will never surrender their sovereignty.So what's going to happen next? Is it going to be everlasting standoff, or the situation is going to escalate?
The issue is very simple. They can catch the people who fund terrorism. They have their names. They can stop their media from being a platform for people to justify suicide bombings. Very easy. Turn off the switch. They can stop their interference in the affairs of other countries. It's a policy decision. When you have...Weapons going to an Al-Qaeda affiliated militia in Libya. That's wrong. You stop that. Is it that difficult to stop your military
transport? So I get your point. So you don't think the points are difficult, but for them, they say they are very difficult. So my question is, what's going to happen next?
We're very patient people. We will not deal with Qatar until they change their behavior.
Is it going to trigger military actions next?
No, why would it? Our view is we're not going to deal with you until you change.And until you change, you cannot use our airspace, you cannot trade with us, and we will not talk to you. It's very simple. And at the end of the day, we have bigger issues to deal with than Qatar. We have the danger of Iran. We have the danger of extremism. We have to support Iraq. We have to bring the war in Syria to an end. We have to stabilize Lebanon. We have to liberate Yemen from the Iranian-backed and affiliated Houthi militia. We have to stop the fighting in Libya.We have to take on Boko Haram in the G5 countries. These are all much, much more important than Qatar. Qatar, in the larger scheme of things, is very, very, very small.
在对话中，朱拜尔一再表示，沙特一直以来坚决打击恐怖主义，对于暗中资助恐怖主义的政权和组织零容忍。今年六月，特朗普赞扬了沙特为打击恐怖主义做出的贡献。今年早前，中国国务委员兼外长王毅曾就沙特的去极端化问题接受媒体采访，赞扬了沙特建立世界上第一个去极端化教化中心，提出回归温和伊斯兰的系列举措。
Speaking of extremism and terrorism, how do you understand the origin of terrorism in Middle East?
I think the terrorism, we had terrorism involving the Palestinian-Israeli conflict that triggered a lot of this. We have terrorism from Al-Qaeda when the Afghan, the people, the Mujahideen from Afghanistan came back. Osama bin Laden was able to form a group, Al-Qaeda, that engaged in terrorism. And it evolved then into Daesh and it evolved into other groups. We believe that the reason we have terrorism is because you have extremism. And when you have extremism and you promote hate, that leads to violence, which is terrorism. That's why the positions we took against Qatar were so firm. You cannot, we are trying to fight extremism and we are trying to stop people from spreading hate. And you are giving them a platform and giving them money. That has to stop.
But back to my question.
Yes.
How do you understand the causes for extremism?
Intolerance. It's
ideology?
Hate. An ideology of murder. And I think these are psychopaths. And we have to take them on. We have to make sure that they don't use religion to try to justify murder. And we have to make sure that we have laws in place that punish them. And we have to make sure that we have a banking system and a financial system that does not allow transfer of funds to such groups. We have to have oversight of where money goes. We have to have mechanisms in place in order to track cash couriers. All of the things that we in Saudi Arabia have been doing for a long, long time.
在朱拜尔看来，仇恨和不宽容是中东恐怖主义的根源。从上世纪阿富汗战争开始，西方国家在中东地区扶植的民间武装力量不断扩散，蔓延到多个国家。再加上近年来发生在中东的几场乱象环生、内外势力复杂的战争，基地组织、伊斯兰国、努斯拉阵线等不同恐怖势力环环相扣。2019年，根据美国标准，伊朗伊斯兰革命卫队也列入了恐怖组织。而根据伊朗标准，美军中央司令部及其驻西亚部队也被列入了恐怖组织。叙利亚是乱局的一个重灾区，这里能看到美国、伊朗、俄罗斯、土耳其等多国身影。沙特也多次表示愿意派兵前往，尽管因为各种原因，沙特战区没有跨入叙利亚国境线，但是在叙利亚问题上，沙特却有着一以贯之的坚定立场。
You have repeatedly said that there's not going to be any future for Assad in Syria. Speaking from now, are you still standing at the same point?
I think what we've said now is the conflict in Syria has to be resolved peacefully.We've always supported the Geneva Declaration, Geneva One Declaration, and UN Security Council Resolution 2254. And we have always said that this process requires a transitional council, the writing of a new constitution, and then elections. And the Syrian people can decide what kind of future they want and what kind of government they want. We don't believe that absent reconciliation among the Syrians,that you will have peace in Syria.
Well, you once said that Bashar al-Assad will either be removed by force or by political process.
I think the support that the Syrian rebels received in the beginning of the conflict was too little. I believe that more could have been provided to them that would have changed or altered the course of what is happening in Syria. Now we have to deal with the reality. The reality is there is no military solution.And the reality is it has to be a political process, and I think the international community is in agreement on this issue. Now the question is, how do we bring it about and how do we move this process forward? We have worked with the Syrian opposition to unify their position 3 years ago. We have worked with them last fall to adopt a common platform that calls for a transition period and that calls for a new constitution and elections and that calls for a peaceful resolution to the conflict. And now we're trying to work with the other partners in the international community to move all the parties towards this.
I mean, let's say if Bashar al-Assad is managed to be elected by Syrian people, which he is according to the record of Syria, let's say in the future there's a general election with all the international observers and Bashar al-Assad is elected, will he again still be removed by force?
If the Syrian people have to decide who their president is, and whoever prevails in an election will be the president. But I find it hard to believe that the man who is responsible for the murder of 600,000 people and the displacement of more than 12 million people will be elected by the people of Syria. I just can't.